question. We do have a microphone, and we'll just pass it around. Hand up, we'll bring it to you.
The mic is necessary because otherwise.
Here at Lawrence Tech College of Architecture and Design, sponsored by the Detroit Studio Master Urban Design Program at the college. My name is Constance Boduro, and I'm an assistant professor and also the coordinator of the Master Urban Design Program. When I understand the dean will be joining us, we'll introduce him when he arrives, and our chair, Daniel Farr, is also here today. So we got a bit late, so I will keep the introductory comments to a minimum. We do want you to be aware of the Master Urban Design Program. There's some flyers on the refreshment table, as well as my card. Please do let us know if you have any questions. I would like the students that are both in Detroit Studio and in the Master Urban Design to stand up, so you know who those students are. Okay, great. Vast majority. Excellent. So if you have any questions, you can ask them. Join us. So I'm going to serve as moderator for today's dialogue. And we are honored to be joined by a number of distinguished guests. Mr. Douglas Farr, who literally wrote the book on sustainable urbanism.
That's true.
Mr. Farr is an architect and urban designer. He's the founding principal and president of Farr Associates. He served as the co-chair of the Environmental Task Force of the Congress for New Urbanism, chair of the AIA Chicago Committee on the Environment, and the chair of the U.S. Green Building Council Lead for Neighborhood Development Core Committee. Most importantly, though, he is a native Detroiter and a graduate of Cass Tech. So, welcome. Mr. Farr is also joined in dialogue by Dr. Jun Sup Kim, who's here as an associate professor and director of our own Detroit studio. Stephen Vogel, who is the former dean of the University of Detroit Mercy School of Architecture. And we are hoping to be joined by Ms. March Winters, who is the deputy director of planning and development for the city of Detroit. March was delayed and hopefully will be joining us. So our intent is this dialogue is very informal. We designed it so students would have a chance to interact and converse with Douglas and June and Steve and Marja. We want your opinions on sustainable urbanism. We particularly want to talk about Detroit. Is Detroit sustainable? Should Detroit be sustainable? How can Detroit be sustainable? We encourage you to offer your ideas and opinions. And we will also ask Mr. Farr to make a closing statement. But first, we'll start with some definitions. So the Master of Urban Design Program here at Lawrence Tech defines sustainable urbanism as a balanced and holistic systems approach to design and policy initiatives that address the complex environmental, economic, and social forces that affect global, city, and regional form. So that's our working definition. So as a way to begin the dialogue, we'd like to ask each of our discussants to offer their definitions of sustainable urbanism.
Can I go
Douglas,
first?
Douglas, you are our guest.
Yeah, thank you. So ours is more concise. Walkable, transit-served urbanism, integrated with high-performance buildings and infrastructure. It's 11 words. How many words is yours?
I'll count. Well, while Steve goes, I'll count. Walkable, transit served.
Urbanism, integrated with high performance buildings and infrastructure.
Okay, great.
Well, lately we've been using two words. strongly was thinking of sustainability more in terms of social and economic dimension. Then I went to another meeting in Brightmore, and they were having a meeting about defining their neighborhoods. They tend to focus a lot more on environmental aspects of their neighborhood. I also went to a conference in Seoul, Korea last year, and they were having a discussion about sustainability, and one of the things that came out of the symposium is to promote sustainability more in terms of the global context. So I think depending on where you are, you tend to focus on a certain aspect of sustainability, but I think they should address all three, triple bottom line, which I think is need to be addressed if you want to promote more holistic sustainability. I'm sorry for the long answer.
Thank you all. We've been joined by our dean, Dean Glenn McLeroy. We'd like to introduce Glenn.
Thank you.
Joe, and we've already read our official definition of sustainable urbanism, which is actually 26 words. So longer than that.
Sure.
But I don't know if you want to add anything in addition to.
What were you asking for 2 words?
Dex said ours was too long.
Oh.
So if you have a briefer definition, please add it.
It's really interesting because I've worked with a lot of communities in the past, and people tend to jump to energy-oriented aspects of sustainability, but when you talk to communities in your community workshops, sustainability to them quite often doesn't deal with energy conservation. It deals with the long-lasting nature, the permanent nature of their community. And is it a community that can be sustained in the long run, economically, socially, in terms of energy, in terms of the completeness of the community. So communities that last are will it last? Welcome very much to our college, and the fireworks are going on.
Exactly. If there's a follow-on, go ahead.
I wanted to make a comment on something Jill said. In Brightmore, it's more about environmental sustainability. And what I'm finding is when you work with neighborhoods that have a lot of vacant land, they tend to gravitate towards that. I mean, very strongly, because here they are, half three-quarters of their community gone, and nature's already taking over, so there is that natural tendency.
Doug, did you have something additional?
I have hours of things. Be careful what you ask.
Like you had a thought, okay? Sure. We're talking about definitions.
My whole take on this is that, if you stick around for the lecture, you'll hear this again, but, sustainability has been...
They had a wire taped in the way of the door closing.
Perfect. So I think the media and maybe all of us have collectively done a disservice to the idea of sustainability by characterizing it initially as a set of objects. It's a compact fluorescent light bulb, now an LED. It's a Prius, now it's an electric plug-in. It was a green building, a LEED Platinum, now it's a living building, right? So they're discrete things, and somehow the idea of community, or neighborhood, or quarter, the place where you live, work, play, and family resides, and your quality of life is determined, is somehow not considered connected to sustainability. And so that, I think that's semantically, communications-wise, kind of step number one is to make that connection. It's okay, even if you live in a great community and you live with a high quality of life and a low impact, whatever light bulbs you use, right, you're helping out, right? So that's sort of message number one. I think that's a messaging thing. And it's really hard, once the word's out, to steer it another way. So planning has been bypassed by sustainability.
seems like, you know, the perception of sustainability, like Mr. Farr was saying, is in an object. It also seems like expanding infrastructure is another thing or item that the citizens grasp onto as like another sign of sustainability or expansion. You know, if you're growing the city or growing infrastructure, then that is another form of
time in the country when we're feeling poor nationally. We used to be really rich and now we can't afford anything, right? So we're in despair, the economy's in the tank, all this sort of stuff. And the Tea Party is out there just as a political force. And what are they about? You know, it's about sort of zeroing out government. It's sort of like, out of my lives, cut the subsidies, blah, blah, blah. There's a part of me that says, you know, if the truth were told, the extent to which cities were taxed to build the suburbs to compete with themselves, and then watches the prices, you know, per capita to operate those, you know, sewer lines for a population of 2 million when you only have 750,000, et cetera. That whole story of cross subsidy is a total scandal. It happened right in front of two generations of Americans, was not talked about, and is still not understood by anybody, right? But those same people probably live in a highly subsidized suburb and, you know, find sworn about subsidy, right? And so there's a great hypocrisy that's hard to reveal to people, but you know, part of me wants to be the kind of, you know, get an army of 100 really smart people like the people in science and devote ourselves to just focusing spotlights on subsidies, right? You know, the other ones that are in daily life, you know, the cost of, you know, cost of gasoline and the tax, highway gas tax, you know, 19 cents, 29 cents a gallon, it's like pathetic, you know, should be $1. The actual cost that a driver pays to use the roads is a fraction of what it costs to maintain the road. It's mostly paid by taxpayers through property taxes of the town you drive through, right? Or if it's a state highway, it's paid by all taxpayers in that state. And so, incredible subsidies to all those sorts of things. And then on things that aren't subsidies but are nonetheless sort of nudges to do more of it, the car insurance policy that doesn't care how many miles a year you drive, flat rate. New insurance policies actually pay attention and your rates go down.
Right.
That's really cool. Like, so you start that car, it's like, shoot, it is 56 cents a, you know, a mile. Boy, maybe I can't afford to drive those 20 miles or whatever. So
right.
Just unearthing all those subsidies.
Well, I think the complexity of trying to convey those, the idea of life cycle cost or complete cost as opposed to, is that the hurdle that we face?
We never faced those costs.
No, we didn't talk about them.
We also, well, also on the same subject, we never talk about social consequences. I shouldn't say never. We seldom talk about social consequences of, say, highways, in which are can be severe. This whole, this desire to move further and further out has huge social consequences.
Prompting people?
Yeah, by the way, are you recording this so we have to speak into a microphone?
Yeah.
I'll wait for the microphone. to me, this is another definition of sustainability, is the world itself on a completely unsustainable track in terms of population, in terms of our settlement pattern, in terms of our energy consumption, in terms of the type of energy we're creating and consuming. I mean, are we to a path not only for our cities, but for the earth itself in terms of having created a completely unsustainable planet? Downward, isn't it?
Wow. Well, you know, it seems obvious to say that population's going to grow. I think the studies I've been reading says, you know, 2050, maybe more like 9 or 10 billion.
Yeah.
I think that's where we're going to probably be. So that's a given. But, you know, the impacts are, you know, have everything to do with your level of material wealth. So if everyone on the planet lived at the quality of life in Afghanistan, we could support 30 billion people because they're so meagerly demanding of Earth's resources and have a very low standard of life, you know, because of that. So if everyone's from New York, or say not New York, but West Bloomfield, that would be bad. That would be, you know, many, many planets addition required to
see. Yeah, Bloomfield Village?
I don't know these places. It has the name Bloomfield. Point being, you know, the big thing, cities are the foundation of sustainability, right? Cities compared to their peripheral suburbs are virtuous. The people that live there have lower per capita impacts on the earth, richer choices, all the kind of benefits you can talk about, but environmentally speaking, Manhattan trumps any other city, and in any city, trumps its suburbs, right? So sometimes it's a factor of, you know, 30%, sometimes it's double. Impact is double in the suburbs. Why would that be? The person that lives in the city that has this tiny unit, no car, few possessions. I lived in Manhattan 3 years ago. We went shopping. It was a negotiation about whether we could actually bring that object home if we had room for it. Oftentimes you felt like, if I buy this thing, I'm going to be sleeping with it in the bed because there is no further place that I have a use in my space. And so it puts a great regulator on what you acquire and what you consume. So the other extreme being the huge McMansion and one car or more per adult, which is, you know, common in Detroit and in other places. That's the unsustainable part. So it's not just numbers, it's sort of what you're all learning about.
Frank, yes.
May I ask a question on that? I lived in Manhattan also for about 12 years, and it's really, by the way, my name is Frank Harden. Was on faculty here in AI. And I lived in Manhattan for almost 12 years, and there is a lot of anecdotal evidence that points to the fact that Manhattan seems to be sustainable, but, and I don't know this for a fact, but there's also a level of wealth that's generated by people who work in Manhattan that requires the production of many things around the world to support that lifestyle. So, while it may appear that a single person living in Manhattan in a small closet that's called an apartment is using less energy, that person, by the mere fact that they are kind of aggressive and creative and producing in a company, and the food has to be shipped from way out in Pennsylvania to get to them, may not be quite as sustainable as a village development, which has agriculture nearby, where they get everything locally. So I don't know if there's facts about that, but I'd be interested in hearing.
Can I respond with one anecdote? So it was mentioned in the introduction, I chair the LEED neighborhood development, which is a standard you'll hear about later, but it's the first LEED standard that applies to certifying sustainable master plans or places. And I advocated for, and we included one credit out of 100 to LEED ND that was about local food production. And my co-chair on the core committee is a gentleman named Kate Benfield from the Natural Resources Defense Council, an environmental group. And we were arguing on the phone one day about this, and, you know, we've got to get local food. It's such an obvious thing. And I cited the statistic that food miles for a fresh plate of produce to arrive from where it's grown to a medium plate is, you know, 1,200 or 1,500 miles, etc. And Cade revealed to me, he said, you know, actually, we at NRDC are a little scared because we've actually so efficiently on CP rail from there to your marketplace, it's actually less energy consumptive to have it come, in many cases, a further distance than a 4 mile per gallon truck drives it for 30 miles to your, yes, it's closer, yes, it's local, he said, but it's very nuanced. So, you know, that's one thing. But on the Manhattan thing, certainly, if the family has 6 homes, only one of which is Manhattan, and their wealth allows that, and you're drawing a line around Manhattan, just measuring Manhattan, you're not capturing their full impact. Or if they log 100,000 air miles a year, but live in Manhattan, you know, same point. It, you know, corresponds to this idea of wealth. Now, Andreas Duan, if he were here, would say, hey, you know, if you play this carbon game, what you're going to end up with is finding that poverty is the only answer, right? That what we really all need to be is from Afghanistan, and let's not beat ourselves up. Humans have to be happy. You can't scold them into doing the right thing. They have to choose it out of free will. It's got to be seen as a better choice, not a worse choice. So it's complex.
I'd like to pick up on this idea of lifestyle, and this is an attempt maybe to get the students involved in the conversation. Because Douglas talks about U.S. lifestyle in particular as a central challenge to sustainability because the rest of the world is mimicking us, right? But he also observes that the rest of the world is way ahead of us. So, you know, on a per capita basis, even the really successful and growing companies like India and China consume a fraction of land, oil, energy that we do. They, instead of driving, they walk, they bike, they use transit. And they also, he makes the point, they also have leaders that are, you know, looking to the future and implementing sustainable practices. So maybe you could comment as students about your own lifestyles or about the lifestyles in regional Detroit and where we can go. What can we do to impact that? Please.
Well, their work and they can enjoy, they can shop, but they don't have to just depend on the cars, which is what we need to lead as urban designers, which is what I believe. Because Detroit is really needed, like as a what we are living now. Because when I walk around and see lots of vacant area in downtown, it's so close to downtown, it's so they are vacant, and why we are not really just a little give effort and make it a little bit more dense and just support with public transportation and, you know, design well, as we talk about, and like my other friends, like give really good example of Woodward. You know, we need to apply these ideas all over Detroit, because I just point of, from your book, like think globally and act local. So this is what I believe also. And I just don't know like how we can make it, like as a student now, how we can lead it, how we can start, where we can start.
No, I think there is a hopeful sign. You know, General Motors dismantled the streetcar and interurban system of Detroit when they were causing it. But General Motors now at the Volt plant, for example, they're producing electric cars. They just installed a 40-acre solar array. They're putting a wildlife preserve on their retention ponds. So it's a sea change in the way the car company thinks. So, and then Ford's doing, you know, their thing out of. And I wonder if the car company ultimately won't be the people that get into the mass transit business. And, you know, in a sense, they caused the problem, so now maybe, you know, 60 years later, they can solve the problem.
Yeah.
Maybe that's hopeful thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Streets where streetcars once were, and that's Woodward, that's Gratiot, that's Grand River, there's a bunch of others. because they tend to have the buildings, the urban fabric is in the right form, right? They're the easiest places to retrofit. We work in St. Louis a lot. Where do they put their Metrolink line? Smack dab down the middle of their busiest streetcar street that was ripped out, like I said, you know, 75 years earlier. They put it right back in. The DNA was there, the urbanism responded, it works, right? You know, at Minneapolis, same deal, et cetera, et cetera. So Detroit's going to figure that out over time. To me, I think that the project we looked at will be wildly successful. If they build the line to 8 Mile and then extend it, you know, towards Birmingham or to or past Birmingham, it'll be wildly successful. People will gravitate towards it because there are enough people in this region that want that lifestyle and can't get it really anywhere. I mean, you could live in downtown Royal Oak, downtown Birmingham, but it's a pretty small pool you're swimming in. You love to be connected to other things. So I think it's going to succeed, but it is an experiment. It's not an experiment. Is a leap of faith for the to make the investment in the transit for the densities there. And so I think you have to build the transit, subsidize its operations to the full hours of the day that a person would need to live a reasonable life, not 6 o'clock, and then eventually the stuff will fill in and will come, and then it will be self-supporting, you know, 10 years out or whatever the number of years out. But it's that leap of faith that's hard to do and sometimes hard to finance. So Detroit can cobble together the shekels to do it. That's the thing.
Okay, so I have a question. So because I don't have a car in the US, I just have been here for nearly 2 months.
Yes.
So the way for me to get to the supermarket, to the post office, is just maybe walking, maybe just by bicycle. So this makes me think deeply about such problem. So I think it's a bit special in Detroit, in Michigan here. I really don't think people who drive their cars are sustainable. I really don't think it's sustainable. I think we should encourage them to give up their cars and to take the public transportation system. As I come from China, and that in China, in Beijing especially, people who purchase cars are limited. They could purchase more cars now since the city is so crowded. So it's a jam, and the jam happens every day, and also for the environment there. So I wonder, is it possible to encourage people to give up their cars, to take the public transportation system by improving the city's infrastructure? So I'm really confused by the problem. It confused me for nearly 2 months, so that's been my problem.
Well, but Shaver, maybe talk, because I know I've heard you talk about how do they incent people in China to take public transportation versus drive a car.
Mm-hmm.
There are things that are done.
We have our methods in China. You know, the best buses, they have the lowest price for citizens to take. It's maybe there are some policies for people to take the bus. They need to pay when they transfer. For example, they just get off from this bus to another bus. In 2 hours, they didn't pay any fee for the ticket. So that's the measures, some of the measures. And also, the parking fee in some downtown areas are really, really high. So people wouldn't drive their cars to the downtown area. And in some really crowded cities such as Hong Kong, they build their city transport infrastructure very, very well. It's very convenient to take you to anywhere in the city. So that's our measures. So I wonder, is it possible here for people to give up their cars just by improving the infrastructure?
Please, jump in.
Simple answer, no. But, no. So I think that, first of all, this is a conversation to have in an academic setting. If you said, as a planner in a public setting, I think people should not have cars or something like that, you may believe that. I may believe that too. Don't ever say it, right? Because it will turn the audience off to what you have to say. What is feasible across the country is to have this conversation, which is a lot of families have, as I said, one car per adult, right? That's expensive. Each car on the road is, you know, $8,000 or $9,000 or $10,000 a year. The cost of the car, insurance, upkeep, blah blah blah. Right? In a time when wealth is very thin, to give a family here's $50,000 more a year, like, my goodness, that's like a great raise in work. Like, that's really good. So if your family has three cars, could you go to two? Or two cars, could you go to one?
Yeah.
Right, so it's always shaving a car, drop a car. That's a welcome conversation, and then it changes the dynamic. So a lot of times you say, you know, you have three cars, why do you have three cars? You say, well, Thursday night, I have bowling and I have PTA, and we need two cars one night of the week, so we have to own three cars. So we have to time out. Wait, that's where a share car, for example, could come in handy. Sell your car, sign up for the share car program, and on Thursdays, one of you is taking the share car, right? But you can't support a share car unless you have enough density, because you have to be able to walk to the car. You can't drive to the share car to get a car, because then you still need to own the car. So it goes back to urban form and density and complete neighborhoods. And so if you have super low densities, share cars are not viable. If you have reasonable urban densities, just complete blocks, they don't have to be super dense, you can put a share car. My ideal is one per block, one per several blocks. And then you sign up for it on the internet, or you can sign up for it wirelessly, all these different ways. And then the family is wealthier, they still have their mobility. That's how you, that's effective. And then people say, where do I get a share car? And then the conversation changes. Like, we'd like to look at that. I'd like the $8,000. Our family would like the $8,000 a year, thank you very much. So then it changes. You're not infringing what's considered a freedom or a right. You're offering a new choice that saves them money.
I think the root of the issue, though, this goes back to the issue of government, is because the federal government doesn't have an energy policy. And one way to automatically boost mass transit is to increase the price of gas. You know, we talked about that earlier. You know, in Europe, what would a gallon of gas be in Europe, like $8 a gallon or something? Well, of course they're going to have mass transit, because who wants to pay $8 a gallon? And they're going to have more efficient cars, or they're going to have no cars. So, you know, when the gas prices have been rising, I was sort of hoping they would go further.
Right.
I mean, look what happened already. All of a sudden, we have an electric car that, you know, 5 years ago we didn't think about, right? Or General Motors didn't think about. Well, what would happen if $2 are added to the price of gasoline? You know, next thing you know, we would have a mass transit system. So, yeah, that's sort of forcing people out of what they would want. I think the other issue is we haven't seen it. You know, we actually have a mutual client, Cormac Barron Salazar.
Was there?
And I remember we were doing a project for them down in Atlanta. And the people, it had to be a public housing project, and the people were talking about what's important to them. And it came down to having worships in the units, worship prior in the unit. And the only way they could convince them to vote to have this project done is they flew them to Pittsburgh and said, I mean, to some of the leaders, and said, here's the unit you're going to have, right? And that's it. They turned around. They're going to have warships and drivers and units. That was it. I think if people from Detroit actually saw a light rail system in action, and, you know, some of the cities we've named, or Portland, or, you know, I think they'd change their minds immediately. And I'm talking about suburban people, too, because suburban people don't spend their money to travel. They spend their money on mansions, you know. So they haven't really seen the world very much. At least I find that with my students, because their parents don't travel. Even the wealthy parents don't travel. Yeah, so how do they know? You know, have they ever seen a city that actually works? You know? Have they ever been to Berlin or to Hong Kong? You know?
Frankly, in the denser urban areas of North America, it's the wealthy who use transit more. Yeah. If you look at the Eastern Seaboard, right? There's all sorts of commuting in to the city, you know. Anyway, Doug.
I was just going to say, I was in Houston last week trying to sell, basically, ICE to Eskimos. I was trying to sell zoning in Houston, which is famously the only city in the world seemingly that doesn't have zoning. But they do have light rail, and it works just fine there. And they were strategic about what it touches. So it touches the downtown, the sports facilities, Rice University, and it's well received even in Houston. And so, you know, those of us who do travel know, you know, Salt Lake City is a mecca of public transportation. I was absolutely shocked. And the Mormons get it. San Diego gets it. You know, of course, San Francisco, of course, Portland's always gotten it. Seattle's getting it. They relate to transit. But I mean, just travel at all, and all these places have it. Denver.
20 cities in the United States by population. Detroit's the only one that doesn't have a new transit system, a relatively new transit system.
Or a transit system. Chicago would be relatively new. But
I mean, I'm keeping the people
high quality transit system.
Keeping the people right. who are out of this equation.
Well, that's it. We're getting close to our hour, but please, if there are other students that want to add, even if it's a different topic other than transportation and mobility, you know, other topics related to our city and region in regard to sustainability.
Okay, I have
good.
One. John, and it is a little bit of a topic. It's more of a definition. In the context of sustainability, how do you define infrastructure?
Well, that's a great question. Well, let's see. It's certainly public facilities like streets and roads, sewers, power lines, street trees. I consider infrastructure, parks and open space infrastructure, navigable and non-navigable waterways, stormwater facilities. What am I forgetting? That was a list. It wasn't a definition.
Community centers, fire stations.
Yeah. Fire stations, schools, police stations. Certainly all. What's your definition?
Well, I was just curious because in some of my research, you know, the idea of what is typically considered infrastructure, you know, we think of infrastructure as buildings or bridges, but from my perspective, when looking at urbanism, and specifically sustainable urbanism, it could be parks. I mean, it could be the land itself that becomes the infrastructure. So I was just curious to see.
Public works. Public works is a good one. There we go. The winner of the concise definition award. But I was going to say, just, you know, in sustainable urbanism, I used it to refer to, for one niche, narrow passage, which was this. Start, because I have a foot in urbanism and I have a foot in green building. And the green building movement lead launched itself with the premise that we will make the world a more sustainable place, one building at a time. When lead came, in my inbox in an internet, in an email in 1998, its premise was unchanged to this day, which was to say, our vision is that each building will be its own power plant, its own sewage system, its own rainwater facility, its own transit facility. Like basically one building at a time, we're gonna ask you to honor thresholds and credits and criteria that ask that you redundantly deliver what should be public works, right? So they integrated with high performance infrastructure, came out of that to say, if your end game is to do incrementally better, you can optimize a building only so far. Look at Europe, look at Asia. The direction to get to the efficiencies that I think are interesting and actually make more money, you always have to go to district systems. Rarely is the building on its own the optimal scale. And why is that? There's economies of scale to some bigger equipment. There's natural economies when you have diversity of use on a, say, heating and cooling system. So, some residential things with some office. Why is that? Because the residential isn't occupied at the same time that the office is. So you can share loads. One needs heating, one needs cooling. That's one piece of equipment. Those kinds of things. So you really want to scale the infrastructure correctly. So the green building movement, one building at a time, would still have you plugging into, everything is a separate building, and that's not the way Europe, which I consider the leader in this, is doing. So, but that's my narrow sub-definition of infrastructure.
Just out of curiosity, could you add to a broader definition of infrastructure something beyond public works, private name, grocery store? I mean, is that just one of the underpinnings of a community that without which you don't really have that? Version 2.2, however. But do you think then LEED and D will be the better example of LEED as far as the
building.
Yeah.
Similar to like the Living Building Challenge, which actually, from what I know, is more of a net zero concept,
sure.
where LEED, you know, being LEED accredited, you know, it's a point system.
Yeah.
And I think, but I've done some research last semester on LEED ND, and it seems like LEED ND might be a little more, you know, holistic.
Yeah.
Certainly, LEED ND, you know, seeks to certify entire master plan developments, right? Could certify the entire Woodward corridor that you were just studying. If it's a little hard, then you could conceivably have to teach. The way I like to characterize all of this is that there's a really vibrant sort of marketplace of competing certifications, standards, labels out there that are all fighting and competing with each other. And it's really lovely to watch. And so one often begets the other. So for example, you know, LEED was started, the term was coined in 1996 by a drafting committee, actually by Rob Watson. You know, and if you look, Google him, you find him, he calls himself the father of LEED, which is so, whatever. And it was 1996. So then, but it hit the street in 98 and 99, and it was this one building at a time, right? And it was mimicking what was already done in England under BREEAM. So BREEAM was first, LEED was second. And then Living Building grew out of inadequacies of LEED, as did the Architecture 2030 Challenge, which said, LEED, are you kidding me? That's all you can do on energy? Give me a break. You know, the world's cooking at this rate. By 2030, we would have to have made this huge boomerang of a turn. You ain't getting there. So I was on the LEED steering committee when 2030 happened. It was this really aggressive net zero standard by 2030. Watched as LEED doubled down and started very slowly, but if you see the out years of LEED, by 2018, LEED will be net zero. So Ed Mesri and the 23 Challenge did that. And then, so then LEED ND comes in and says, all y'all are playing in the sandbox. It's about individual buildings. That misses the point. It's about communities, there's scales, and you're not building quality of life, you're building a narrow sort of quality of indoor living or something like that. So it's scaled up. When LEED ND was published, 1 year later, BREEAM in England published BREEAM for communities, right? So there was like a leapfrogging and building up. And then Living Building Challenge, after LEED ND was launched, Living Building Community, Living Futures Communities, right? So everybody's stealing and borrowing and competing. It's really, it's a lively time, but it's cool. It's really cool. And you'll be better.
This gets to the issue of landscape urbanism, which, well, I guess we did. That was a private conversation, never mind. But the idea of, and I don't know if you agree with this or not, that LEED's going to eventually go away into these bigger ecological regenerative systems. And, you know, to look at it on a very big scale, and which is really what you're saying, not the scale, just the building.
Right, well, it has to be systemic, right? We can't look at things discreetly. So I think we've come to a time, unless another student hasn't spoken, has a burning issue to raise.
I guess I'll just add.
Good, jump in there, man.
I just wanted your guys' opinion on what you think the most important thing our region needs to become sustainable.
That might be a nice way to go about a closing statement for each of you. I think each of you should respond to that.
Personally, I have to go with mass transportation. I could name all kinds of things, but transportation is the major issue of this region.
June, what do you think?
To me, since the trustee is working on the Woodward project, we have learned that since last year that there is clearly lack of collaboration among cities who are affected by the heavy use. So clearly, I feel like collaboration is something that we should really work on.
Mr. Farr, would you like to
have
the last word? And then please feel free to make a broader closing.
I should have said Mr. Farr is my dad.
Douglas.
I'm Doug.
Doug, okay. So Doug, please.
You say Mr. My dad will be here.
Excellent. I'll look forward to that.
No, I would be a close cousin to what you said about transportation. I think it's actually just placemaking. To me, places and mobility are just fused like your spine is to your flesh and your circulatory system and so on. So, I mean, if Detroit's weakened, even a bigger thing than transportation is placemaking. We all agree that Woodward Corridor would look like Curitiba, the kind of, you know, Berkeley's pretty good at a lot of things, you know, kind of that kind of thing. But it's great. So, you know, the thing, you shouldn't say collaboration, I think there's a lot to that. Because we were talking again at lunch, you know, who do I fight with? How would you do too to get good projects? I fight with traffic engineers, I fight with civil engineers, I fight with mechanical engineers, I fight with fire marshals, I fight with building code officials who want me to treat my stair as a single-use conduit to get out of the building in case of fire, but not to use on a daily basis to be attractive and inviting and open. Code slaps my hand on that. So it's like all the rules and all the people with authority, I come back and say the authority of power around me are wrong. They're dead wrong. And so I would want to come in and say, who, if I'm eye-to-eye, toe-to-toe, fighting out with this guy, a traffic engineer, you're dead wrong, and I don't like, but I don't have authority over you. Who wins? The person that gets the mayor to call the public works guy, that calls the head of engineering, that calls you, and says, back down, the mayor wants it this way. That's how it's decided. So, you know, that's on the negative side, like when you're hostile. And it'll be hostile for a while because the traffic engineers are still being trained in the wrong stuff, doing the wrong things, and their professional culture reinforces all that. So that's a long time. Those people do have to also die off quicker rather than slower. But on the upside, I think the potential here is that you are collaborators, you are leaders, you are truly leaders of teams. You set a vision, you figure out how to inspire people, you figure out who the leaders are that can throw the switch to get your vision to be the vision, and you indulge a little bit in politics. I know you do if you've done all the projects you just said. I know you do. And you can't be the artist that ascends the garret, comes up with the sculptural winning, the dairy whip cone that just happens to just barely stand up and won the, you know, star architect competition. Like, that's a niche for architects. I think it's overplayed. We don't need any more of those people. If you're going that way, you know, I think it's kind of a dead end. Don't do it. What we need a lot more of are people that are essentially generalists that see the big picture, but have some technical capacity that you can speak well, you can draw well. You're persuasive, you command facts, ideally all four or five of those things, and then you're good with people, and you can figure out to buttonhole. I love mayors, so I like to buttonhole a mayor because I know they can get my stuff done, right? So anyway, all of those things, if you can go out and become sort of super robot, RoboCop was filmed in front. You could be sustainable urbanism RoboCop, but really nice looking and polite and all that sort of thing. If you go out and do that, that would be winning. But think of yourselves as leaders, and expect opposition. Expect fights. If you're not getting any opposition, you're probably not doing anything. Right.
That's a wonderful way to conclude. Yes, thank you so much. Thank you to all our panelists, Doug Farr, Steve Vogel, Jim Club Kim. Thanks to all of you. You really made the dialogue wonderful. Thank you for taking your time to join us. Oh, of course, yes. I think hopefully all of you know that Mr. Farr will be delivering a lecture at 7 o'clock right across the hall, A200.
Yeah, all new material.
Okay, great. No repetition?
Please, if you're going to your studio or you're around the halls, please remind everyone to come to the lecture tonight.
And also, hopefully next year we'll have a bigger group for the dialogue.
And the last thing about the lecture, my last five slides, I said to Jen over lunch, I think, demonstrate 1,000 jobs for architects. 1,000 jobs. Right? And it's not what you think. So I'm just going to show you the picture and you say, tell me there aren't 1,000 jobs on this one slide, right? So may expand your horizon about what you're going to do.
Jobs.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. See you all next year.